Hey guys, what's up? I want to do a show and tell of a special rifle that is easily recognizable. If you live in the US, you should know this rifle. So I'll open up the box and show you what we're working with today. I see a glimpse of wood right here. Nice M1 Garand. See what it says here. U.S. rifle caliber 30 M1 Springfield Armory. And oh, this is a short barrel. This is a, what do they call these? The tanker model. That's what they call it. That's really short. Well, let me put the box away and let's and bring back the rifle. We get on with this show and tell here. Give me just a second while I go off cam for you. This nice looking rifle. This wood's really nice on here. Alright, so here we have a M1 Garand tanker model here, 18 inch barrel. Just like the standard M1 Garand with the full length barrel, but this one has 18 inch barrel instead. Caliber 30-06. As you should know, it takes the end block clips, makes that classic ping noise everybody knows and recognizes even from the old Medal of Honor video games from PlayStation, from the first PlayStation. Man, oh man, it's so nice to have a gun like this to hold on to a piece of history right here. Wow. This rifle is not a part of our collection. This is a friend of ours. He let me borrow it. And you know, I asked him to say, hey, I want to take a look at one and browse. And he said, yeah, sure, no problem. So here, I'll just give you guys some background history. It's made by, designed by John Garand, and made by him as well. The original name was actually 30 M1. That's the original name. And then it was soon to be called the M1 Garand in future years. What else was there? Oh yeah, this originally was chambered in 276 Peterson or Pedersen. I think it was 276 or 273. It's a very uncommon cartridge to me. I've never heard of it until you know, I started looking into this. But yeah, it was originally chambered for that. The clips would hold 10 rounds. It was basically a 7x51, not 7.62x51, just 7x51, kind of like the 6.5 Jap 6.5 Arisaka. And I think there was also a Swedish caliber that was similar in size. So that was the original chambering, and then when they realized that it would work for 30-06 from, you know, 1906, Springfield 1906, they said, well, hey, why don't we just, you know, use that cartridge to be better. It's a heavy-duty cartridge. You know, it's got a lot of power behind it, a lot of speed. So that's why it can only hold 8 rounds. Everybody always wondered, why is it only 8? Well, originally it was designed to hold 10 of that 276 Peterson round, or Pedersen round. So, this one, I cannot tell the gear model of this one, but I have some other stuff that you could probably narrow down the year model. The tanker models were called, they were tanker models, and they were also paratrooper kind of models, and those were the shortened ones with the 18-inch barrel, and those were called T26, version T26. Now, they also had one that was a side folder. I think it was called an M1E5. Yeah, they had a side folding, or it was just a folding stock. It must have been side folding. Again, probably paratrooper kind of thing. Those are the other models. And then everybody knows the full-size M1 Garands as well. I'll give you guys a close-up shot here of this rifle. So here I'll show you guys the grain of the wood. The wood on this, the stock on this gun is really, really nice. I don't know who finished it, but they did a really good job on it. You can definitely see the grains in that thing. Look at that. Looks really nice. So let me show you the couple features here. This is common to many rifles, even the old classics, to have a trap door in the buttstock, right? And this one has two holes. You can carry a cleaning kit, oiling bottle, or maybe some ammunition, something like that, something of that sort. And then here's the receiver. Someone refinished the receiver. They did a pretty good job on it as well. You can see the workmanship on it. Really nice. Nice and thick black. Dark coat. Oh, and I just remembered, yeah, it was a 276 Pedersen. Was the original chambering. I think I also said 267. Yeah, I think it's 276 for sure. Okay, and then here's a cool little thing. Well, not cool, it's different actually compared to most other rifles that we see today. Or the safeties are usually like up here, or they're flip down levers on most of the World War II era rifles. But this one has a lever that you put, or kind of like a tab that you push forward and back through the trigger guard. Right, so you see that slit, and it goes through there. Just like that. So that was kind of different. I think the M14s and M1As have the same thing. I don't know why it's like that, because it would be kind of difficult to do with your finger, like this part of your finger right here. Like when you have your hand here, it'd be hard to push it forward like that, because it would probably cut into your finger. So I felt that was kind of weird, actually. Maybe not so much as neat, but weird. And why it has a hole in it has got me a little confused as well. So here I'll show you guys the top view of the receiver. Right here. I gotta definitely cover up that serial number so you guys can't see it. I'll try to get some close-up shots, but the finish on this thing is really nice. And the front sight. Right there, obviously standard GI aperture. Peep sight in the rear. Makes it really, really, really accurate. That's a long, long distances. From what I've heard, it's still used in competition as a target rifle, because it's very accurate, and some people modify them if they're not. But I've seen people have service competitions with them. We've seen all kinds of video clips of people doing that. So also the production years for this rifle, I don't think I mentioned that, was 1963, from 1936 to 1963, and that's quite some time. And there's been over 6.25 million, or around 6.25 million of these made. Not the tanker model just alone, but that includes all the models of M1 Garands that were made, or M1 30 caliber M1. I forgot that for just a second. But yeah, 6.25 million, that's quite a bit, that's a lot. This particular rifle, actually the tanker model, I found to be worth around, I did some research and I found them to be around, let's see, $800 to $1,000 easily. I've seen some go for more than that. Of course, there are some like very desirable classics that are going for like $4,000 or $5,000, is quite a bit. But this one right here is probably in the I'd have to say closer to $1,000, maybe $1,200 range. Just because when I spoke with our friend who let me borrow this, he said it's he has never fired it, and we will be firing this one. And so he hasn't fired it, but I'm sure it's been fired before, because I've gone into here and looked around, and it's has some wear, so it has been shot. It's not like it's an unshot or never been shot original rifle, you know, or anything like that. So I'd have to value this one at about $1,000. And I think most M1 Garands are in that area. M1 Garands, and I'm going to compare it to the FN49 because it is very similar to the FN49, which shoots, as you guys probably could recall, the FN49 shoots an 8mm bullet versus the 30-06. Here's a 30-06 shell, right? And then here's an 8mm. And you can see the height differences right there. Actually, the back of the casings are identical, so they actually fit the same. And I got my German Shepherd climbing into my table real quick. What are you doing back there? Come on, get out of there. You're gonna trip over some stuff. All right, he's just venturing off. He's a little pup. So what else was I was going to say something else. Oh, yeah, in World War II, around that time, 1940s period, 1945, you know, in that time frame, this rifle was selling for $85. Or exactly, I think that was probably the purchasing price or the cost to make it. So $85 back then, and now they're worth about over $1,000, depends on collectors, what collectors are willing to pay and the quality of the rifle and whatnot. Let me get some... try to get some close-up shots of the breech in here. And this rifle, like when I'm talking about comparing it to the FN49, is much different than the FN49, whereas the FN49 takes tripper clips. It has a box magazine. You know, and the end block clips are, they're good and all, but they're really specific. And you have to have those to fire it, otherwise you're gonna put them in one by one. And I didn't get any end block clips with this, so I'm going to have to fire it one by one. Let me see if I can get some light in here. I can't get much light in there, but you guys can see down in there, it's pretty clean, really nice. And that's like the follower, kind of. I can't. If you push down on this, if you're not familiar with M1 Garands, let me let you in on something called M1 thumb or Garand thumb, and that's because when you push down on this, it releases the bolt forward. So you got to be very careful of that. Let me see if I can demonstrate that without putting my thumb in there. Here I got this little paintbrush thing. All right, let's try this. So you just let me get this real quick. But everybody who has an M1 Garand knows about M1. Wow, it's not actually doing it. All right. Oh, that's not good. So, let's try it again. I think it's taunting me for me to put my thumb in there. I'm not going to do that. But yeah, so when you load these up, you actually have to... you push in your end block clip, and it goes down into it, and you push it down just like that. You push it down, and actually the whole the recoiling system, how it operates, actually shoves rounds up to be picked up and to be forced into the chamber. And I'll show you guys that in my breakdown disassembly video, so you guys will see that in detail. And I'll show you that one thumb in that. So, all right, so you guys can see that there. Some other thing I noticed a little weird on this gun was the sling points on this, where there's one back here, there's one up here, right here, and then there's another one right here. I wasn't sure of that. I think that's because it's a tanker model, maybe. Maybe that's why, because the handguards are longer on the standard ones. Of course, it has the bayonet lug up in the front, and a lot of people think that this is completely gas operated. Well, it's not. It's kind of like a piston design, kind of like an AK, or you know, the AK is kind of like this. I'll show you guys how it works, and you guys can kind of see the similarities. I'm not sure exactly the name of the mechanism, but it reminds me of an AK kind of mechanism. Not entirely, but pretty close. So that's the M1 Garand tanker model. Very beautiful gun, 30-06, very nice cartridge to shoot, very powerful. Put some hairs on your chest. Alright guys, so that's the show and tell of the M1 Garand and the tanker model. If you guys have any questions or comments or anything like that, or any information you want to let me in on, please let me know and put in the comments below or send me a private message. That's fine as well. Alright guys, I'll talk to you later.